Committee will come to order, and at this time, the chair would like to recognize Representative from New York, Mr. Graham.
Thank you, Chairman and Ranking Member Grijalva and members of the subcommittee. First of all, thank you for taking me out of order. I appreciate it. And also for holding today's hearing on H.R. 2606, the New York City Natural Gas Supply Enhancement Act. Congressman Meeks and I appreciate your interest in our legislation authorizing the Secretary of the Interior to allow the construction and operation of natural gas pipeline facilities in the Gateway National Recreation Area. As noted in the attached August 22nd letter from Robert Yarrow, the President of the Regional Plan Association of New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut, to Congressman Meeks and I, in support of H.R. 2606, if enacted, our bill will expand the supply of natural gas in New York City and therefore help support future economic development consistent with New York City's Plan NYC. The Plan NYC report is part of Mayor Bloomberg's effort to address the city's aging infrastructure. Anticipate 1 million additional city residents expected over the next two decades and strengthen the city's economy. The report notes that one of the city's most important needs is to increase natural gas transmission and distribution capacity, and further adds the natural gas pipeline facilities addressed in our bill would actually critically reinforce gas supplies in Brooklyn and in Queens. The Williams Companies, a major natural gas supplier, is proposing to build a lateral pipeline off an existing Transco pipeline that will bring much-needed natural gas directly into New York City. The new lateral will pass underneath Gateway's beachfront Jacob Riis Park in Queens and underneath Jamaica Bay to a meter and regulator station located at Floyd Bennett Field in Brooklyn. It will then interconnect with National Grid's existing distribution system. A portion of the project will bring additional natural gas into the Rockaway section of Queens, which currently suffers from a lack of adequate capacity to effectively serve the growing demand in this area of the city. As the subcommittee is aware, the Park Service generally lacks the legal authority to permit natural gas facilities inside park boundaries, and Congress has historically given the NPS this authority on a case-by-case basis, subject to restrictions and conditions depending on the nature of the project. Our bill is consistent with this long-standing practice. To this end, I respectfully request that the subcommittee approve our bill. And thank you again for your time and consideration. I appreciate it, and for taking me out of order. Thank you so much. I yield back.
I thank the gentleman for yielding back. Mr. Graham, you're certainly welcome to stay if you would like to hear the remaining testimony and questions. At this time, I'd like to recognize Ms. Bonita Cleveland, the chairwoman for the Quileute Tribal Council, for your comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman and other members on the committee, on behalf of the Quileute people, thank you for allowing us to speak about how our children and our elders could be killed in a tsunami unless we move our village to higher ground. Watalichi Asosta, Watalichi Asosta, Watalichi Asosta. Thank you, thank you, thank you from the bottom of our hearts. With me today, Mr. Chairman, I have members of our delegation from our tribal council, Ms. Deanna Hobson and Ms. Carol Hatch. Although the Japanese tsunami is a very recent reminder of the destruction that happens after an earthquake in the ocean, our people have been living for decades upon decades with the fear of a tsunami and the flooding. Our tribal council has produced a video that we would like to share with your committee today. With your permission, Mr. Chairman.
So ordered.
The recent tsunami in Japan will always be remembered for the devastation left behind in its path, and the catastrophe provides a critical and timely warning. Just across the ocean from where the tsunami struck Japan, the Quileute Reservation lies at the mouth of the Quileute River on Washington's Pacific coast. For over 100 years, the Quileute people have been restricted to less than 1 square mile of land surrounded by Olympic National Park. Pressed up against the sea, the tribal schools, offices, and homes are all in danger.
It's tough, you know, to make the call to see if we could get out of here on time. You know, during the drills, you know, we came awfully close to that, mark where we would seriously be in danger.
If we want to save Lepush of what we got left here, I think that needs to take action right away. I think next year might be too late.
Thank you. So as you've just seen from the video, our community knows that our school children and our elders will not get out in time. Our children are really worried, and I want to share with you a piece of artwork from one of the students that show their fear. With your permission, Mr. Chairman.
Go right ahead.
He drew this piece of artwork, and it has all the emergency responses on it and the big tsunami wave and them running for cover. So I'd like to leave that open for people to look at. Thank you. Because our village is located on 1 square mile between the Pacific Ocean and the Olympic National Park, we simply have nowhere to go. There's only one road in and one road out of Lepush. The road is usually covered under 3 to 4 feet of water when flooded. For decades, my uncles and my auntie negotiated with the Olympic National Park to try and bring resolution to dispute over the boundary of our reservation. Finally, last year, we were able to reach an agreement with the park to settle this dispute. We would like to express our deepest appreciation to Park Superintendent Karen Gustin for her hard work and her understanding of the dangers of our tribe faces. The legislation that Congressman Dix introduced would allow the Quileute tribe a permanent way out of the danger zone. For many thousands of visitors that visit Lepush and the Twilight fans, the bill will ensure permanent access to our beaches through the trailhead the tribe does own. H.R. 1162 will also return to the people a cultural and sacred site known as Thunder Field. Our people have utilized Thunder Field to gather berries and a place to put in their canoes for fishing. Finally, we have the opportunity to make a difference for our people, who have always had such close cultural ties with the land base since the beginning of time. Without this bill, the tsunami danger could lead to extinction for the Quileute people. We are very grateful for the letters of support for the legislation from the governor of the state of Washington, the mayor of Forks, and the National Congress of American Indians. In addition to these letters of support that we have already been submitted for the record, just yesterday we received a strong letter of support from the Clown County Commissioners, and I also ask this letter be included a part of the record.
Without objection, so ordered.
Thank you. So, Mr. Chairman, my fellow council members and I have been honored to represent our people in your house today, and I hope our words and the videos and the photos show you how desperate our tribe is in need of this Bill 1162. Wa Tlachiasosta. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Cleveland, and I would make one editorial correction. This is not our house. This is your house as
okay.
Well. This is the people's house, and we're glad that you're here.
Thank you.
The chair would recognize at this time Ms. Mary Ann Menard, Director of Curriculum for the York School Department. You have 5 minutes, ma'am.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee. Thank you for this opportunity to share the importance of the York River to the York River community. And thank you, Congresswoman Pingree, for your hard work on the York River Wild and Scenic River Study Bill and for giving me the chance to speak today. Whether teaching the leaders of tomorrow or educating the parents of today through our schools, a curriculum that utilizes the natural resources around us can mean creating a community that cares for the value of those resources. The York River community has embraced this concept. At the York Schools, we understand the value of a wild and scenic river study to our children because our curriculum provides our students from first grade all the way up through high school in courses such as biology and chemistry at high school, hands-on learning experiences about the unique qualities of the York River. A wild and scenic study of our river will support and augment the protections currently being pursued by the York River community, and it will serve to provide important information for community decisions. And this study will provide opportunities for student involvement through the curricular areas of science, technology, social studies, service learning via the school department strategic plan and our commitment to promoting opportunities for students to be active and engaged citizens participating in learning experiences based on application. We recognize the need to motivate and prepare our students for career opportunities. Our 21st century learning skills are critically important to us. Inquiry-based learning is the center of what we know makes sense for students. And we appreciate the expanded connections with community organizations that a wild and scenic river study will provide for our schools. Our schools partner with community organizations, including the Museums of Old York, the Wells Estuarine Reserve, the Gulf of Maine Research Institute, the York Rivers Association, the York Land Trust, the Friends of the York River, the York Public Library, and the York Rotary Club, in order to preserve and learn about the unique aspects of the river. The additional surveys, monitoring, and partnerships that a study bill will allow our students to pursue will make lessons exciting and allow our teachers to grow professionally as they collaborate with community members who share their expertise freely. In each grade, our curriculum currently sets out a different learning goal that has to do with exceptional biology and history lessons for our students regarding the qualities of the river. These lessons include learning about the rich history of the York River, which dates back to the 1600s, discovering the importance of clean estuaries to the diverse fish and wildlife of the watershed region, learning about the ecosystems of the York River, exploring geographical features, and conducting research on vernal pools that helps the York Land Trust advocate for responsible development in the watershed area. And in high school, biology students get a chance to build their leadership and communication skills by developing a unit that is hands-on and teaching that unit to our first grade students. Your written testimony package includes images of our students engaged in learning activities focused on the York River. Activities supported and often involving community agencies and volunteer mentors. The faces in those images reflect the genuine eagerness and hope that all of us in the York River community have for the future of our river. And I request that you take a moment to look at those photos as they represent York's future in a way more powerful than any written statements I could hope to provide for you. As you consider H.R. 2336 and the designation of the York River for study under the Wild and Scenic Rivers Act, please consider the vital role that the unique qualities of the York River play in the young minds of our community and in our leaders of tomorrow, and the real benefits that that designation for the York River study, for study under the Scenic and Wild Rivers Act could mean for our entire community. Given the real development pressures in the York River watershed, our community needs a comprehensive understanding of those aspects And they need to understand that our river needs more protection and restoration in order to continue to provide ecosystem services and preserve the living history of our nation and our area. Thank you again, Chairman, Ranking Member, and members of the subcommittee for holding today's hearing. And thanks again to Congresswoman Pingree for her hard work and all the members of the York River Study Community that have come together to seek this study under the Wild and Scenic Rivers Act.
Thank you, Ms. Menard. At this time, the chair recognizes Ms. Wanda Thornton, the Accomack County Board of Supervisors.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Gavalda, members of the subcommittee, thank you for this opportunity to address you on House Resolution 2087. My name is Wanda Thornton, and since 1996, I have served as a member of the Accomack County, Virginia Board of Supervisors. Accomack County is the northernmost county in Virginia's Eastern Shore. I am here to represent the County Board of Supervisors today. We have come to Congress because only a legislative remedy can remove a federal deed restrictions on county-owned facilities in a responsible manner. 35 years ago, in 1976, the United States government granted Accomack County approximately 32 acres of land adjacent to the NASA Wallops Flight Facility. The 32 acres had been deemed excess federal property, and the land was given to Accomack County under the auspices of the Federal Land to Parks Program, which is administered by the National Park Service. This land was given to Accomack County with a deed restriction and required the land to be used only for recreational purposes. When this transaction occurred in 1976, the property had essentially no value, and no one could have foreseen the tremendous economic development opportunities we have before us today. Consistent with the program's parameters, Accomack County placed a softball field on the property and called it the Wallops Park. Unfortunately, the local citizens chose long ago that this park had fallen in disrepair, and they decided to move to other facilities. We have numerous facilities, ball fields, five new ones in a 5 to 10 minute drive from this same facility. Federal initiatives to privatize elements of America's Space Flight Authority and the retirement of the space shuttle programs have brought profound changes to NASA, including a surge of commercial investment and activity in and around NASA Wallops Flight Facility in Accomack County. The county has responded proactively to these challenges. Accomack County has negotiated a Space Act agreement and ground lease with NASA to gain direct access to a NASA Wallops Flight Facility runway. NASA is cooperating with Accomack County in order to accommodate private aerospace business that will support NASA's emerging privatization model. The land lease from NASA and to the sublease for private business to develop is fully one-third of the development known as Wallops Research Park. The only way the Wallops Research Park can be developed is for the county to get clear title to the Wallops Park, the recreational area with the federal deed restriction. Due to its location adjacent to the NASA property, the Wallops Park property is now appraised at $815,000, or more than $25,000 per acre. This is on the order of five times the value of other land in our county that could be generally suitable for recreational use. Federal law requires the appraisal to be value of the property at its highest and best use. Because the appraiser knew of our plan for the development of Wallops Research Park, the property was assessed accordingly. After extensive discussion and negotiation with the NPS Land to Parks Program, we were told that their policy required Accomack County to acquire another recreational property to serve as its replacement. We were willing to pursue this route until we were told that the National Park Service Program Administration and Department of Interior's no net loss policy required Accomack County to replace Wallops Park with a new land at least equal in monetary value or as opposed to simple recreational value. We have tried repeatedly to convince the National Park Service to allow us to replace the recreational value of the property rather than the monetary value. They have told Akamai County and Republican Ridgel that they cannot change their policy. This is why we need the legislation to do so. Akamai County is one of the poorest counties in the state of Virginia. We certainly do not have $1 million or more to spend on the purchase of land and construction of a new park. The taxpayers of Akamai County do not support this unnecessary expenditure, even if we had the money. We already have numerous park facilities in the county, and as elected officials, we could not pursue this course of action, knowing full well that this would be a poor use of our taxpayers' money in this depressed economy. We are pursuing the development of Wallops Research Park in coordination with NASA. Numerous commercial interests have expressed strong interest in locating adjacent to the NASA facilities. Wallops Research Park will create several hundred good-paying jobs in the space and aerospace industry. We want to move forward, but we cannot until this deed restriction is removed. The road goes directly through this piece of property, and we cannot proceed without it. House Resolution 2087 will remove the deed restriction and allow us to proceed with our goals of creating new jobs and keeping our community at the forefront of America's space and aerospace research and commercialization. I thank you for the opportunity that you've afforded me today. I would be happy to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the witnesses for your testimony this morning. At this time, the chair recognizes Ranking Member Mr. Grijalva for any questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Chairwoman Cleveland, in this effort to reach agreement on the best way to move your people out of harm's way, how many years of work did were required to get to this point where we have the legislation before us?
It's required over 40-some years.
And the tribe fully supports the package deal that's in the legislation. Am I correct on that?
You're correct, yes.
Thank you very much. Mr. Frost, and thank you for your patience for waiting around. Appreciate it. Regarding H.R. 2087, the county legislation, are the requirements of the federal land to parks program dictated by MPS, or are the requirements dictated by Congress?
As I understand it, it's part of the Federal Property and Administrative Services Act of 1949. So they're dictated by Congress, not by the National Park Service or by GSA.
Okay. Yeah, because the website for the Federal Land to Parks Program says that there are more than 1,500 properties that have been transferred through this program. And does every property transferred come with the same reversion clause requirement that we find in this case?
Yeah, yes.
And follow up on that. So potentially you could have 1,499 other communities who would like to be excused from that clause.
That is exactly right.
Okay, but I ask those questions as we go forward with this legislation. Should we be worried about a precedent that we may be setting? And in that, whatever that answer is, what kind of language could be suggested that would mitigate any precedent setting on the legislation that you can think of?
That is one of our concerns, is that it could be precedent setting, as you stated. You know, the law provides ways to move land, I mean, to revert the land back to other uses. And so I think, you know, the intent of the original transfer of land to the county was for recreational purposes. And so the current legislation as it stands doesn't, it just basically removes the deed restrictions, and it doesn't provide for any of those additional recreational values. There's also a monetary issue there, in that the land is inherently has some value, and it doesn't provide any reimbursement to the federal government for those for that value.
And the last one, Mr. Frost, on the gateway legislation, your written testimony mentions the need for some amendments in order to refine resource protection and lease rent language. Can you maybe explain that part of your testimony?
Absolutely. There are some technical corrections that we'd like to make. But in addition, we want to make sure that as the hangars are restored where the pumps are going to be, that they are done in compliance with Secretary standards for historic preservation. And then there's some minor language that needs to be revised in terms of the leasing agreement and things like that. But those are pretty minor.
Liability issue. If there's an accident, gateway again, or something goes wrong with the pipeline or with the project that results in damage to park resources, where does the responsibility for that liability lay?
I'll have to double check, but I believe that the legislation states that it lies with the applicant and the pipeline, the company. Okay. That's going to be doing the work.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman for yielding back. The chair recognizes itself now for a few questions. In regards to HR 1162, Ms. Cleveland, did you request the wilderness designation in the bill? And is this wilderness designation part of your agreement with the Park Service?
No, we didn't request the wilderness in the bill. However, the agreement is settled with the Park Service with the wilderness in the bill.
So it is part of the agreement with the Park Service?
It's in the bill, yes.
Okay. Ms. Thornton, in regards to HR 2087, how many jobs will this project create after any planned construction is completed?
We don't have a total figure, but we estimate it's going to be hundreds of highly skilled jobs. And this don't just benefit Virginia. We live almost on the border. NASA's almost on the border of Maryland. I mean, this is going to be a big boost for both Maryland and Virginia.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Frost, in regards to HR 2336, can you describe the temporary protections that are put in place during the study period?
I got to make sure I get the right bill.
The wild and scenic bill.
Right. So in terms of protections, I guess I don't understand what you mean by protections.
Aren't there protections that are going to be put in place during the study period?
Well, I think this is just a study period, so we're looking at, you know, whether this segment of river will meet the criteria as a wild and scenic river, and so there's really no action here. It's just a study.
Are there going to be any restrictions put in place during that study period time, and if so, how long will the restrictions be in place?
I don't believe so, but I'd have to double check on that.
Can you get back?
I can. Yes.
To the committee on that.
Absolutely.
Ms. Menard, on that same bill, are there private property owners along the river, and are they aware of this potential designation?
There are private property owners along the river, and we certainly have done, I think, an admirable job of communicating with them. We widely advertised public meetings because we wanted to hear from all segments of the population. Our property owners are very strongly in favor of protecting the river and are definitely advocating along with us. Congressman Pingree held an event in our community this spring. And during that time, people had an opportunity to talk about what the river meant to them from many, many different facets. Everyone from our lobstermen talking about the importance of fishing to our residents talking about the wild and scenic beauty that we know we have there, to our other agencies talking about all of the ecological preservation needs. So yes, there are definitely some homes, some very humble homes, some very beautiful homes along that river.
Have you validated that each and every property owner has been contacted to make sure they're aware of this potential designation? I mean, other than just public broadcasts, has there been direct contact with each property owner?
Representative Johnson, I would have to get that answer. I think that the people who are very involved and whose testimony has been submitted, particularly Joe Donnelly's testimony as part of the York Rivers Association, may have that information for you, but I can certainly
Could you find out, please, and respond back? Thank you.
Certainly will.
In regards to H.R. 2606, the New York City pipeline, the bill calls for, Mr. Frost, the bill calls for revenues from this project to remain at Gateway for use in the park without restriction. Could funds be used for anything at discretion of the park superintendent outside the appropriations process?
I'll have to get back with you on that, but that's what it appears. But I'll have to double check on that.
What sort of reporting or accountability would there be over the funds?
Well, we, you know, the superintendent does an annual report every year to the regional director, and they sort of account for, you know, the things they've accomplished in those years and how the not only their appropriated dollars but all their non-appropriated dollars are used. And so there's some inherent accountability. I don't think the bill calls for any specific any reports to Congress or anything like that.
Okay. Well, if there are no further questions, we will conclude this hearing today. I want to thank each of you for your testimony. Thank you for coming in. The chair would now request unanimous consent for statements from the National Park Conservation Association and a letter from State Senator Linda Parlett be entered into the record. Without objection, so ordered. Though no further business before this subcommittee, without objection, the subcommittee stands adjourned.